Let's start with cargo and freight. Cargo or freight can refer to goods, raw materials, produce, etc., being conveyed, firstly, for commercial gain, and secondly, in bulk, by air, sea or land. Often, such business cargo is packed in transport containers, at times referred to as intermodal containers. Tell me more about intermodal containers. Okay. So, intermodal containers. What are they? Intermodal containers are large, standardized shipping containers built to stack securely, and that also comply to various standards that regulate the transportation of goods, by air, sea or land. Although a variant of the sea and land containers may be used to transport cargo by air, the idea is the same, that goods can be stored and transported via different modes of transportation, whether by air, sea, or land, negating or at least minimizing the need to transfer goods into other different transport containers, and that any necessary transfers can be done quickly, avoiding delays. Freight forwarders move goods in bulk via intermodal containers. It's worth noting that some large FPOs also offer such freight services. More on FPOs shortly, but next, freight forwarders. Freight forwarders. So, when transporting goods, in bulk, for commercial purposes, in the midst of a supply chain, whether by air, sea, or land, then you will need a freight carrier, or freight forwarder, if you didn't want to deal with a transport company directly. Carriers and transporters distinguished from freight forwarders. Although freight transport is different from parcel transport, at times I refer to companies that transport freight or parcels, using general terms, such as carriers and transporters. Why? This is to distinguish from persons, expert in the logistics of goods movement, who liaise with such transporters and carriers, on your behalf, who I refer to as, freight forwarders. But, why would I hire a freight forwarder? As a beginner, if you don't want to deal with a carrier directly, then finding the right freight forwarder for your business is key. As you gain experience, you might then deal with carriers and transporters directly. A good freight forwarder can be well worth the cost, as they remove the effort and worry from all aspects of your goods transportation. Usually freight forwarders can sort out all the paperwork and nitty-gritty for you, including haulage permits, and warehousing costs, insurance, tracking as well as customs clearance. Customs clearance is a distinct set of rules, including those customs-related aspects of haulage and warehousing. Logistics is a separate industry with its own rules and regulations regarding goods transportation. Logistics and customs bolt together to ensure the lawful, safe and efficient transportation of goods. Freight forwarders often offer customs clearance services, on top of planning and executing the logistics of your goods movement. Also, should anything go wrong in your movement of goods, a human freight forwarder can deal with insurance claims, on your behalf. Automated freight forwarders. Alternatively, if you only have simple, straightforward transportation needs for your freight, you might consider one of the automated freight forwarder websites. Simply enter your needs and that is it. If your transportation needs are more complex, involving multiple modes of transport, and subject to varying rules from one country to another, then you might prefer to deal with a human freight forwarder. If it's your first time using a freight forwarder, and especially an automated freight forwarder, find the Contact Us page, and do find and speak to a human representative about your needs. Some freight forwarders offer an online freight calculator on their website. If so, you can enter some details that to some extent replicate your intended goods movement, and see what comes up. Getting quotes for freight movement. We previously discussed knowing your requirements, and then getting several quotes. This is often part of any outsourcing strategy. To understand your options more fully, you might consider getting a mix of quotes from a variety of sources in the freight movement industry. Speaking directly to the freight carriers themselves, and getting quotes from them will help. You can also speak to, and get quotes from, freight forwarders that you find. You might also try freight calculators, or contact support at automated freight forwarder websites, to get help, quotes and more information. You can then weigh up the pros and cons of each source. What sort of costs might I expect in freight movement? General examples are transport costs, goods handling, temporary storage, packing costs, legal and admin costs, and more. Transport costs and surcharges, for fuel for example. Some land and sea routes may incur tolls. Also, depending on your requirements, transport costs might also include goods handling, crane loading, and refrigeration. You may also need temporary storage or warehousing. Packing, as well as costs for storing and transporting goods and cargo on pallets, known as palletization. There will also be legal documentation costs, such as insurance, haulage permits as well as customs clearance costs, which include licenses for controlled or hazardous goods. You will also need to pay for the admin fee charged by the freight forwarder. What if I only want to send a few parcels? Well, on the other hand, you could try fast parcel operators, or FPOs. But we discuss fast parcel operators in following videos. But next. We'll dip into the gov.uk website to find out more about freight forwarders. We're on guidance. Get someone to deal with customs for you. And freight forwarders. What are freight forwarders? These are persons or organizations specializing in freight movement and shipment of goods. Over time, freight forwarders have also adopted software in common and compatible with government customs and excise agencies, for example NES and CHIEF, discussed later. As such, they are able not just to organize freight, but also arrange clearing through customs, if required by their customers. To get some more information, we'll briefly skim guidance, freight forwarding, moving goods. At https://www.gov.uk/guidance/freight-forwarding-moving-goods. Freight forwarders oversee the worldwide movement of cargo, packing, documentation and customs clearance, on behalf of importers and exporters. We'll unpack this statement a little bit, by going through a smattering of bullets. So, scrolling down. Down a bit more. Ah yes. Movement of cargo and packing. Movement of cargo first. Freight forwarders take into account, and manage, all forms of logistics, risk, and security issues, in the movement of cargo. Cargo packing. We see here that freight forwarders are specialists in the safe, effective, and efficient packing of goods. All this, to ensure goods are received in the same condition as when they left the consignor, warehouse or factory. What is a consignor? When it comes to goods movement and transfer, a consignor, also spelled with an OR at the end, is the sender of goods. For small businesses, this could be the seller. For larger businesses, could be a carrier. Anyway, anyone who directs the consignment to the consignee. Consignee. The person responsible for receiving the goods, could be the buyer, or warehouse, etc. The transfers of title depends on the contract. Yes, okay. Also, customers must inform and liaise with freight forwarders, at an early stage, on issues relating to fragility of cargo. And more here. But we'll skip and head back to the top. Documentation. What are the documentation requirements? Freight forwarders are expert in all forms of documentation required for moving cargo. For example, they must first receive clear and timely written instructions from the importer or exporter, i.e. well in advance of when the goods are to be moved. Confirmation of the requirements should also be received by the customer from the freight forwarder in writing and all well in advance of the goods movement. Invoices, packing lists, and licenses must also be supplied by the importer or exporter. Also, as transport might be by any combination of air, sea and road, freight forwarders will be familiar with all the related documents of carriage. Back to the top. Up, bit more. Okay. Customs clearance. Freight forwarding requires some sort of customs broking. Scrolling down. A little bit more. Customs and frontier controls. Freight forwarding requires some sort of customs broking, and as such freight forwarders will either be able to do this themselves, or they will have in their employ, a customs agent or broker. We see mention of handling any bonds or guarantees required for duty and tax payments. We will introduce customs guarantees in later videos. We get confirmation here of the sort of software used by freight forwarders, i.e. software compatible with HMRC software. Software used for declarations, reporting and payments. Also required for customs clearance are commodity codes. So, the UK tariff. Freight forwarders are familiar with the UK tariff, and therefore likely to be familiar with the UK trade tariff tool, which we covered in part one of this course. And scrolling down. Just a little bit. Responsibility for the declaration of hazardous goods also lies with the carrier. So, freight forwarding, moving goods. Should you wish to revisit this guidance, find it at https://www.gov.uk/guidance/freight-forwarding-moving-goods. Finding freight forwarders. How do I find freight forwarders? And we're back on this guidance, get someone to deal with customs for you. Scrolling down, and we see that you can find out how to use a freight forwarder on the British International Freight Association, or BIFA, and also the Institute of Export websites. So, we'll take a very quick peek at both of these. Let's click BIFA. We see member search, but if you wish to ask somebody about your requirements, to help focus your search, you might wish to start with contacts. British International Freight Association. Main switchboard and email here. And a list of administrative contacts below that. Could be useful. Close out of here. And next. We've also got the Institute of Export. Click that. And over here, we see, contact us. Let's take a sneak peek at that. Scroll down a bit. Okay. Two sources to help you find freight forwarders. Great. We'll close out of here too. So next. When dealing with freight agents and forwarders, and especially for the first time, it might help to understand the basics of how they operate. When dealing with freight forwarders, bear in mind that risk management is the cornerstone that informs on how they operate. And we're on. Guidance. Freight forwarding, managing risk. If you are thinking of exporting goods by using a freight forwarder, then it might be useful to understand why they operate as they do. Specifically, how trading conditions and insurance can limit the financial risk for freight forwarders. Overview of freight forwarders' responsibilities. A brief recap of what they do. Forwarders act on behalf of importers and exporters to get their clients' goods to their destination on time and in good condition. This means booking cargo with shipping lines, airlines, rail or road carriers. We see here that some, I guess larger, freight forwarders even have their own transport facilities and act as carriers themselves. A forwarder's other responsibilities include preparing and checking bills of carriage, arranging insurance, ensuring the lowest possible customs charges are levied and, where necessary, arranging storage. Trading conditions and limiting liability for freight forwarders. Many elements of international contracts between the seller and buyer of goods can impact on the contract with the freight forwarder employed to move those goods. But the accuracy of this information shapes the risk. What risk? Scrolling down to freight agents, avoiding the risk of customs civil penalties when arranging exports. As freight agents act as third parties for arranging exports on behalf of exporters, they are obliged, for customs purposes, to extract certain information from the exporter. We see that customs hold freight forwarders responsible for the accuracy of information given in documents, as well as the authenticity of documents when attached to a shipment. If freight forwarders fail to take all reasonable precautions to ensure the accuracy of such shipment documentation, then they face the risk of customs civil penalties, CCPs. So, in order to protect their businesses, freight forwarders operate under trading conditions. What do these trading conditions include? Scrolling up to trading conditions. Freight forwarders use trading conditions to allow them to operate whilst limiting their liability. These conditions cover many aspects, including informing the client of the insurance status. Often this boils down to letting the client know their goods are not automatically insured, explicitly or implicitly, conveying that the client should make separate insurance arrangements. Trading conditions also include safeguards to ensure payment after the job is done. Also, these conditions include clauses protecting the forwarder if the client fails to fully disclose the contents of a consignment. Examples here. For example, failing to disclose hazardous material, goods of an exceptionally high value, and so on and so forth. And down a bit. Despite being able to limit liability, the freight forwarder still has some level of responsibility for loss and damage to goods. To sound out professional advice on trading conditions for freight forwarders, you could go back to the website of the British International Freight Association, BIFA. The British International Freight Association, BIFA. https://bifa.org. We visited this site earlier, but to recap. BIFA. The leading body representing the UK international freight services industry, implement trading conditions for freight forwarders. The BIFA Standard Trading Conditions 2017 downloads can be found here. These are for the exclusive use by current BIFA members. And why should freight forwarders use BIFA Standard Trading Conditions? BIFA trading conditions are an easier and cheaper option compared to employing your own solicitor to draft separate conditions for each contract. We can take a very quick look at their leaflet. 2017 BIFA Standard Trading Conditions, a short guide. Quick skim. Phone and email at the bottom. It wouldn't surprise me if we refer back to BIFA in a later video. For now. Not forgetting those freight forwarders that also act as carriers. And to that end. Conventions. And. National and international transport conventions, or laws that govern each mode of transportation, also play a similar role to trading conditions, including limiting the liability, but this time, of the carrier, or freight forwarder /carrier. And we'll touch on transport conventions in a later video. For now. As we previously mentioned. Freight agents act as third parties in arranging exports on behalf of exporters. And that's nice. But what information do freight forwarders need from traders? Scrolling down just a bit, we see a list here. HM Revenue and Customs, HMRC, recommend that freight agents should routinely request the following information from exporters. EOI. We introduced EOI in a previous video. An EOI generally is required, unless the goods being moved are private, non-commercial goods. For example, personal household furniture. Or if the exporter is not registered for VAT in the UK. If the exporter does not provide an EOI number, freight forwarders should check if they need to apply for one, prior to moving their goods. Name and address of consignee, i.e., the next recipient of the delivery. Also down here. Details of the final destination of the goods. Prior to the expiration of the Brexit transitional period, UK freight forwarders should check that these addresses are outside of the EU. To qualify as a direct export, both addresses should be outside of the UK and EU. To qualify as an indirect export, the consignee address might be in the EU, whereas the final destination is outside the EU. And we talk about direct and indirect exports in other videos. This checking is required prior to the end of December 2020 to ensure accuracy of statistical reporting related to exports. It's worth noting now, though, that after December 2020, the UK is an entirely separate trading area from the EU, and all goods destined for addresses outside the UK should automatically qualify as direct exports. And we briefly touch on trade statistics in a later video. Moving on. Auditors need to connect the goods movement stored in customs electronic systems to records in the trader's own accounts. The Declaration Unique Consignment Reference, or DUCA, identifies the goods declaration. But don't worry. We introduce the DUCA and also the MUCA in later videos. But, for now, freight forwarders need to ask that traders append their own in-house job reference as the last part of the DUCA so that customs can link the goods movement to records in the trader's own transaction systems. If travel is by air, then airway bill numbers, AWB numbers, are often used as the last part of the DUCA. Freight forwarders should send the complete DUCA and any associated MUCA back to their client exporter as confirmation of their declaration identifiers. This will also assist at a later stage for audit purposes. If the exporter does not supply a DUCA, then the appropriate guidance given in the tariff should be followed to generate one or to take other steps. Also, when freight forwarders submit exporter declarations and notifications to customs, they should not group these DUCRs and declarations for convenience sake. They should ensure that a declaration is made for each exporter. This last clause usually applies unless the freight forwarder is approved to operate under an HMRC Memorandum of Understanding MOU. But not to worry about this MOU now. We discuss the FPO Memorandum of Understanding in later videos when we look at fast parcel operators. So what other information should freight agents request from their customers? Shipping or flight details, if known. Correct value of goods and correct currency code. Also, we introduced commodity codes in part 1 of this course. Freight forwarders, not acting as customs agents, should request commodity codes and a clear and unambiguous description of the goods, their quantity, marks and numbers, from exporters or their agents. When recording these details, commodity codes should not be grouped, once again, just for convenience sake. Freight forwarders should also request any reference numbers already issued by HMRC for previous authorizations for duty or VAT relief. This also involves customs procedures and customs procedure codes. Freight forwarders need to ensure these are correct and specified on the appropriate declarations. We look at customs procedures and customs procedure codes, CPCs, in later videos. For now, customs procedures identify, in broad terms, why goods are being moved. If the goods are being re-imported back into the country after initially being exported, then reliefs or refunds on duties already paid may be applicable. But why should goods be brought back into the country after the initial export? There are many reasons, but commonly, goods may need to be processed overseas before being brought back into the country for sale or for further processing. In any case, the correct CPC or customs procedure code, in broad terms, will inform customs of why the goods are being moved and also if the goods are to be brought back into the country at a later stage. And the correct CPC needs to be included in the declaration relating to the initial export as well as the re-import as well. We see a caveat here. If an incorrect CPC is used, it can lead to any customs relief on duty and VAT granted at import, being liable for payment forward / repayment by the exporter or by the freight forwarder. Next. Insurance. Scrolling down to the importance of insurance for freight forwarders. We see. When a freight forwarder is entrusted with someone else's goods, they become legally responsible for taking all the necessary steps to protect and preserve that consignment. This means the forwarder is liable to the owner for any subsequent damage or loss. The accuracy of information once again emerges as a source of risk for freight forwarders. If a client suffers a loss when a freight forwarder gets this information wrong, then the forwarder is exposed to compensation risk. But freight forwarders can manage the risks involved in their business. And the forwarder is legally entitled to limit the amount they are liable for in their trading conditions, provided that these trading conditions have been agreed in advance. And as such, it is important that forwarders bring their trading conditions to the attention of the customer before the contract is concluded. Failure to do so could prejudice insurance cover and invalidate the protections of limited liability. On top of this, we see types of insurance for freight forwarders. To further protect themselves against compensation risks, forwarders can take out various types of insurance to help cover against any compensation to which they may become liable. And one of these may be of interest to you as a trader. But we'll look at several types very quickly. We see types of insurance for freight forwarders. Public liability. Marine. Employer's liability. Premises and contents insurance. Public liability insurance. The general business insurance that covers legal costs and settlement costs incurred when a business is sued by a client or a member of the general public. Employer's liability insurance. If freight forwarders have staff, then this type of insurance covers job-related injuries and illnesses, plus any associated legal fees. Marine insurance. This covers the loss or damage of goods being transported internationally. Marine insurance policies also cover air, road and rail transport. So, if the freight forwarder can limit their liability in their trading conditions, then what is the need for them to have marine insurance? This is the business insurance that might be of interest to you as a client of a freight forwarder. Traders who don't insure their goods during international transport will only be entitled to a fraction of the real worth of goods in a compensation claim. However, many freight forwarders carry their own marine insurance policies as an added value service to provide cover for traders in these situations. So, find out if your freight forwarder can provide marine insurance for you. International trade finance. Often, and because commonly, the financial stability of your trading partners is unknown, overseas trade is carried out using international trade finance in order to provide a degree of confidence with regard to due payments. This often involves arrangements specified in facilities, such as letters of credits and documentary credits, which provide security to both the seller and buyer using means of the international banking system. Freight forwarders need to be able to read or be made aware of some or all of the terms specified in these arrangements so as to schedule applications and documentation accordingly to customs and carriers to secure clearance of goods through customs and the transport of goods to the designated delivery addresses at the appointed times. Managing the risks of freight forwarding. For freight forwarders, risks can never be eliminated completely, but with good practices and training for their staff, risks can be minimized to acceptable levels. This reduces the likelihood of unwanted claims, etc. Also, as we mentioned previously, we see down here again, it is important that forwarders bring their trading conditions to the attention of their customers to avoid negating their insurance cover and invalidating their protections of limited liability. As we have already mentioned earlier and in other videos, getting written instructions from customers is vital for freight forwarders and their staff. This is key amongst all the ways they might minimize their risk. Other areas in which they set up standard operating procedures to help minimize their risk we see include controls over the issue and release of documents. Managing subcontractors, also via written contracts. Handling dangerous goods. And we see HMRC provide more information on this topic. Find the guide on freight forwarding, moving goods. Also, cargo security. And insurance claims. So, up the top here, freight forwarders have within their care or control goods and documents owned by third parties that often represent large sums of money. So risk management is vital to them. As much as they can, they have to avoid liability through in-house carelessness or ignorance. These issues can only be tackled through experience and training. With regard to protecting themselves against external issues, they rely on written evidence, such as written instructions, whether sent to them via email, or in a letter, or specified in international trade finance terms. Also, they rely on a variety of contracts, guidance, and as we saw up here, insurance. If you believe that your interests are protected by forwarders running their business along these lines, then you might bear these points in mind when looking for and dealing with them. And although they may help with many other things, but we'll just touch on one last thing they could help you with. Incoterms. International commercial terms for freight forwarders, Incoterms. Usually the sale of goods happens before freight forwarders get involved in moving goods. At times these contracts are bespoke, written from scratch by solicitors. At other times, they may be off-the-shelf contracts, known as Incoterms. What are Incoterms? A set of international sales terms have been devised by the ICC to remove the uncertainties of different interpretations of terms in different countries. And these terms, which are used to divide transaction costs and responsibilities between buyer and seller, are known as Incoterms. As such, often freight forwarders are left to interpret Incoterms on behalf of prospective clients. For this reason, every forwarder must have a clear understanding of the application and interpretation of Incoterms to be able to give advice to customers. And that's nice. But it is important to understand that Incoterms only cover the contract of sale between the seller and the buyer, setting out responsibilities and obligations of both parties over the delivery of the goods. Incoterms do not apply to the contract of carriage, a common assumption which can cause confusion. Another misconception is that Incoterms are completely definitive and cover all the duties of the parties. This is not the case. Very often the seller and the buyer have to agree who will pay what of any additional costs incurred. There are 13 approved Incoterms. And a few more details here. Some Incoterms have been designed for particular modes of transport. A good freight forwarder will help find and adapt the best Incoterms for you and your trading partner. Great. Okay, moving on. In the next video, more on customs handlers. But this time, customs agents and brokers.